Hi everyone, I'm Dhananjay Tiwari. So he already introduced me. I'm currently in fourth year mechanical dual degree program. I'm part of student satellite program. I work in guidance, navigation and control subsystem of CubeSats. So today I'm going to talk about this difficult to pronounce thing. It's called Zhang-Bekov effect or intermediate axis theorem or tennis racket theorem. So I'm going to cover this talk in five sections. First, I'll talk about its story, how it got famous, by people, like how people started knowing it. And then I will cover in next three sections, I will cover its theoretical explanation, how it can be explained using laws of physics. So in the second section, I will introduce some, I will give some background which is required for further analysis in the sections 3 and 4. So, and section 5, it is about its application, the effect of application of this effect. It is currently not being used, but it is proposed application in space missions. So first, so I'll start with this story. So what happens is this Russian cosmonaut Vladimir Zhang-Bekov. It's really difficult to pronounce for me as well, his full name. So during his fifth space flight on board Salyut 7, which was a space station, on June 25, 1985, so he was on board this space station, and there were certain payloads. Payloads are basically experimental tools which are used for performing experiments in space. So they were transported from Earth through launch vehicles to the space station, and while they are being transported, those while they are being transported, this equipment, they are supposed to be rigidly caged. So because it is very important to prevent their, like, they are very critical, and it is important them to prevent. It is important for. It is really important to prevent them from any damage because of vibrations when the launch vehicle is moving in space, and even when the object is in space, the velocity, they move at really insane velocity speeds. So it is really important to prevent them from vibrations. So what they do is they cage using the background, it is T-shaped. It is just actually so what happens is, to open this, he applies an impulsive torque so that it comes out in just one
Dhananjay, your voice is cracking.
Hello, is it clear now? Hello.
Yeah, it's clear now.
So should I start again or just continue from here?
Yeah, like just last 30-45 seconds.
Okay, fine. So I'll just start this story again. So what happens is he was on board Salyut 7, which is a space station, in 1985, and there were certain experimental the vehicle. So to do that, they use this kind of nuts. These are called wing nuts. So in this background, you can see the nut is T-shaped, but actually they used was a wing nut, which looks like this, the one in the background. So what he does to open the nut, he applies an impulsive torque using his fingers, and then this happens. He applies an impulsive torque. So in this this is just a demonstration video which was performed after he observed this effect, after this thing was famous. But what happens in actual cases, he applies the and on the wing, so after he it moves for around 14
seconds. Dhananjay, your voice is cracking.
Oh, wait. Hello? Hello?
Yeah, now it's...
Is it? Okay, so I'll speak for a... I'll speak more and let me know if it is again cracking. So what he does is he applies this impulsive torque and the actual wind most it moves in the same in along the same line for around 40 centimeters along with its rotational motion. So after that and surprisingly it keeps on repeating this motion while translating. It keeps on changing its direction and there is no external force acting on this body. It is in space, in weightless environment. It is just there's nothing, no electric field, no magnetic field, nothing. It just keeps on rotating and flipping. So it was like a round of backflip. And there is this video which, so this if you can see this video, in this the wing nut used is was actually used in this in the mission. So is the video clear, Sangram?
Yeah, it's clear.
So you can see it is performing its flip motion. One difference is that it is being performed on Earth, so it is moving downward. It is falling because of gravity. That is just one difference. Gravity is not applying any torque. It cannot apply any torque. So what happens? So because they observed this phenomena in weightless environment and Earth also rotates in space, it spins in space in weightless environment, it led to an hypothesis that Earth also performs round of backflips. They performed certain calculations and the time period was predicted to be 12,000 years. And they kept it secret for 10 years from the public domain. Because in cosmic lifetime, in cosmic times scales, 12,000 years is very less. So this planet is unstable. So maybe for some reason they kept it secret. And well, to support it, people started saying that magnetic field also changes its direction. And there were some religious texts which also supported this. But it's true or not, I leave it up to you. We'll get back to this maybe. But it is very controversial. Earth is stable as of now. It does not flip. It does not flip. So it led to this hypothesis. This was an interesting story behind this. So why this phenomena happens? I mean, there is no external force acting on this body. There is no electric field, no magnetic field, nothing. Gravity has no role in this. So why does this happen? Does it have to do something with its shape? Is there something in the body which makes it move, which makes it perform like, so is it because of its shape? That is the only thing which we can claim right now. So before that, we will first understand what a rigid body is. So a rigid body is something, so distance between any two points in a rigid body, it remains constant irrespective of whatever force you apply. Deformations are zero. But a rigid body does not exist. That is also proven from relativity. For practical purposes, we assume small deformations. Like we neglect small deformations in a solid body. And so we assume for practical purposes, we can assume solid bodies with very less deformations. We can assume that to be a rigid body. So we will assume that this nut, it is a rigid body. So every body, because I said it has something to do with its shape, this kind of motion, it is related to, this behavior is related to its shape. So shape and maybe its mass, maybe its mass distribution. When I say mass distribution, the physical quantity which comes in my mind is inertia. So when we did, when we studied inertia in high school, we used to consider rotation only along a fixed axis, one axis. But, and we used to write moment of inertia as summation of mr square or integral of dmr square. And so we used to write that relation for only along one axis. But when it comes to three-dimensional rotational motion, so you see that body changes its rotational axis. When it comes to three-dimensional motion, you need to consider all three components of moment of inertia at the same time. In high school physics, we did not do that. We just used to worry about only one component of moment of inertia. So every rigid body there exists a set of coordinate axes x, y, z, for which I can write the moment of inertia tensor. So when it comes to three-dimensional motion, moment of inertia becomes a tensor, a 3x3 matrix from a scalar value. So for every rigid body, there exists a set of coordinate axes x, y, and z, I call them, for which I can write its moment of inertia as ixx, iyy, izz, and they are calculated from the simple simple relation, which is integral of dmr square. Ixx is along this axis, iyy is calculated along this axis, ixx is calculated along this axis, iyy is along this axis, and izz is along this axis. So one thing to note about this coordinate frame is that there is some noise in the background. One thing to note here is that this coordinate frame, YZ plane, it is plane of symmetry. XY plane is also plane of symmetry. There is some noise coming. No, it's fine. So YZ plane is plane of symmetry, XY plane is plane of symmetry, and XZ plane is not, but is somewhat symmetrical. Y axis and Z axis, they are axis of symmetry. But if I change my coordinate system in some arbitrary direction, my moment of inertia for that coordinate system may not have non-zero diagonal elements. Then the inertia expression, it becomes complicated. But for everybody, I can transform this moment of inertia tensor, this matrix, into this principal moment of inertia by performing the transformation of these, by using this set, this kind of coordinate axis, which something has to do with symmetry of the body. For unsymmetrical objects, this will not be that easy. But for symmetrical objects, this will be very trivial, choosing such set of coordinates. So this was just for information. We'll be using principal moment of inertia further. So now coming to when this effect is observed. So if I consider a rigid body whose principal moment of inertia is ixx, iyy, izz, and if izz is greater than iyy and is greater than ixx, or iyy is intermediate moment of inertia, it is greater than ixx or less than izz, or reverse of that, then this effect is observed when the body is given rotation about y-axis. So that's why it is called as intermediate axis theorem, because this effect is observed along the intermediate axis. So this is the so definitely it has to do something with its mass distribution, its shape. Now we will see why it happens only for this iyy axis, but not this ixx axis or this izz axis. And to explain this, we need to have some understanding about how this dynamics evolves in with time, and that is described by that relation. It was derived in 18th century by famous mathematician or physicist Euler, Leonhard Euler. Okay, before that, why it is called tennis racket theorem. So it can be using a tennis racket. So if we consider a tennis racket, its center of mass. One thing I forgot to mention. In the further analysis, I will consider this coordinate axis to be fixed at the center of mass. So this coordinate axis of this racket is fixed at its center of mass. This is y. This is z axis. This is x axis, and this is y axis. And for a badminton tennis racket, this y coordinate, this axis, which is like this direction, it is intermediate axis. And if I flip this badminton racket along this y axis, it will show the unstable flipping. We'll see in the next slide. So, and that's why it is also known as tennis racket theorem, because it can be easily demonstrated in using tennis racket. So if we see, if I start flipping from here, the white face is up, I give it a rotation about this axis. So it performs its motion, and then at the end, the orange face is up. If you're not able to visualize it, if you want to observe it, just observe it. So this, just see carefully. So this axis, at this point, it has rotated. This was axis of rotation. At this point, its direction is changed. And then here you can see clearly that it is in the perpendicular. So it was along the horizontal. It was slightly along the horizontal line, and now it is along the vertical line of the screen. And at the end, it is in the opposite direction. Now I'll show you a video. You will be able to see the flip. So initially the motion, the rotation is given along this axis, and after some time, so it also rotates along its intermediate axis. So using tennis racket, this effect is easily demonstrated, hence it is also known as tennis racket theorem. Now to show why it happens only along intermediate axis, we will see what these Euler's rigid body equations are. This image is from his actual work which he published in 18th century, and these are the Euler's rigid body equation, which look very complicated in this, but I will show a simple version of it in the later slides. He is Euler. So Euler's rigid body equations, they are very similar to what Newton's laws of motion they describe evolution of a system for translational motion. So Euler's rigid body equation, they describe evolution of a system for their rotational motion. So Newton's second law is what it says: rate of change of angular momentum is equal to the net force acting on the system. Analogous to that, this can be derived by using same principle. Rate of change of angular momentum is equal to the net torque acting on the system about its center of mass. In Newton's laws, the net forces, they act on center of mass. Similarly, net torque, we also consider it about center of mass. Actually, this result, the net rate of this result, is derived from Newton's laws only. So in next couple of slides, I will explain how this Newton's laws, they are derived. For that, first we will understand what is an angular momentum of a rigid body. So I consider a rigid body here. It has, and there are two frames. First frame, this black coordinate frame, this is an inertial frame. We all know what an inertial frame is. And then there is second frame, this red frame, it is body frame. So what does body frame do? It is fixed with respect to the wing nut. And as the nut rotates, the body frame, it will rotate along with it. If I sit in the body frame, I will see no motion of the nut. But if I sit in the inertial frame, I will observe its motion. So let's assume that this body is rotating, this body frame is rotating with angular velocity, omega, and with respect to the inertial frame, and it has certain angular momentum L. And this omega, it is a vector quantity. This omega will have three components, omega 1, omega 2, omega 3. Similarly, L will have three components, L1, L2, L3. And direction of omega, it is given by its axis. It is always along its axis of rotation, given by right hand thumb rule. So omega and L, they are vector quantities. And this is, so from now I will consider all the vectors in the body frame. So there are two things. If I consider a vector, I can write omega, I can resolve its components along this body frame axis. Or else I can resolve components along inertial frame axis. Similarly, I can do the same for angular momentum. I can resolve angular momentum vector, its components along body frame axis, or I can resolve it along inertial frame axis. So I can write it this way. Pi 1, small pi 1, small pi 2, and pi 3, they are components. So x cap, y cap, z cap, they represent inertial. Frame, label them. So pi 2, pi 3, they are components expressed in the inertial frame. And capital pi 1, pi 2, pi 3, they are components resolved along the body frame. So, and I will use this expression. Why? Because this pi, it is angular momentum in the body frame. And I use this expression. So from high school physics, we know angular momentum is moment of inertia times omega. And when it comes to three-dimensional motion, it is just matrix product of these two, I times omega. So when I'm working in the body frame, when I resolve the components in the body frame, I omega, so I it does not vary with respect to the body frame. In the body frame, value of I remains constant. But when I calculate moment of inertia of this body with respect to the inertial frame, I will keep on changing. And also I will have these non-diagonal components as non-zero scalar values. And they will keep on changing because the body is changing its orientation with respect to the inertial frame, but it is not changing its orientation with respect to its body frame. And that's why I will use the body frame components to write the angular momentum. And that's why I will also resolve angular velocity in the body frame itself. So angular velocity is omega 1, omega 2, omega 3. And angular momentum is pi 1, pi 2, pi 3. One important thing to note here is when I write it this way in the body frame, when I resolve my angular momentum in the body frame, I write it in terms of unit vectors along the body frame axis. And these unit vectors, they keep on changing. They are not constant values, but they keep on changing their direction because of rigid body's rotation with respect to the inertial frame. So that is one point to note, and it will play an important role in the next slide. And I will stop here. If there are any questions, I can. Okay, so I'll go ahead. So I will calculate rate of change of angular momentum, because rate of change of angular momentum is equal to the net torque acting about the center of mass. So I calculate, I differentiate it. And when I differentiate it, I will use UV rule. So pi 1 dot, pi 2 dot, pi 3 dot. Dot here represents derivative with respect to time. That is d by dt. But my I, j and k, these vectors, they are not constant vectors. As I said, these vectors rotate with respect to inertial frame. So I will also have to differentiate them. So I will use UV rule. And first I'll differentiate scalar, component values, and then unit vectors themselves. And this is because coordinate axis of the body frame, they rotate with respect to the inertial frame. And this change in the unit vector, the rate of change of unit vector, it is just because their direction is changing. Unit vectors have constant magnitude of 1. Only their direction is changing. So this change, it comes because of body's angular velocity. And it is given by this relation. It is again same as what we used to write, the linear velocity, the relation between angular velocity and linear velocity of a body with, so it was v equal to omega cross r. So it is same. So this represents rate of rotation of a unit vector. So here e cap, so I will just put this value in this expression for I cap, j cap, k cap separately, and then I will have this expression. This will be same, and I can write it in the compact form as omega cross pi. It is just simple algebra from this step to this step using this. And I know that rate of change of angular momentum, it is net moment acting on the body. So it is this relation which you can see, the third relation, it is simply the Euler's rigid body equation. I will just have to substitute values of pi 1 dot, pi 2 dot, pi 3 dot, omega and pi, and I will get three equations which describe the rotation of a rigid body with respect to time. So here tau 1, tau 2, tau 3, they are components of this moment, net moment along I cap, J cap and K cap. So these three equations, they simply come by substituting values of pi 1 dot, pi 2 dot, pi 3 dot and pi in this equation. So pi 1 dot is I 1 omega omega 1 dot, pi 2 dot is I 2 omega 2 dot, pi 3 dot is I 3 omega 3 dot. Here I 1, I 2, I 3 are constant because I chose to stay in body frame. Otherwise, I would have had terms like I 1 dot, I 2 dot, I 3 dot, plus other terms, these non-zero terms. I have this advantage of not using the inertial frame but using the body frame. So now we have developed the we have understood the Euler's rigid body equation, and now we will use this to see why the unstable rotation occurs only along the rigid, only along the intermediate axis. So we are now moving to third section. So when the body, it was moving in space, there was no force, no torque acting on it. Even when in the video, when he spins the nut, the body was moving just under gravity and there was no net torque. So this situation is torque-free situation. So in torque-free situation, in Euler's, if I put torque-free situation in Euler's equation, these three values, they will simply be zero. And I will only have this relation. So I will use this relation for in next slides. So now we will analyze the stability of intermediate axis. Consider a body which has some angular velocity omega, and its components are omega 1 along axis 1. Omega 1 corresponds to this, omega 2 corresponds to this, omega 3 along third axis, and I 2 is an intermediate axis. Omega 2, this component is along the intermediate axis. Now I will consider a case when the rigid body is only rotating about it is purely rotating about axis 1 or axis 3. First let's consider rotation only about axis 1. So when it is only rotating about axis 1, I can, in practical situation, there will be slight rotation about axis 3 and axis 2 as well. So I cannot simply say that omega 3 and omega 2 are 0, but they are very, very small as compared to omega 1. And because there is no force acting on it, no torque acting on the body, the rate of change of its angular velocity, it will also be nearly 0 because it's a pure rotation only along one axis. I can simply write omega 1 dot is nearly 0. I will neglect its time dependence. Now, differentiate equation 2. I simply differentiate this equation, and So the only variable here is only variable in these three equations are now omega 2 and omega 3. Omega 3 is in, omega 1 is independent of time according to our assumption. Omega 2 and omega 3 are very small. So I will differentiate this and then I will have an omega 3 dot term which I can substitute from equation 3. So
Dhananjay,
yeah,
could you repeat how you made this assumption that omega 1 dot is close to 0?
So yes, did you understand why omega 1 is much greater than omega 2 and omega 1 is much greater than omega 3?
No.
Okay, so I will simply consider this body to be rotating. So assume that this body is only rotating about omega 1. It simply rotates about this axis 1. So in that case, omega 1, it will be a constant, and omega 3 and omega 2, they will be 0. Bodies, if you use right hand thumb rule, you will your thumb will point in this direction. So omega 1, because there is no external torque, using simple relation tau equal to I alpha, because it is one dimensional rotation. Now it is one dimensional rotation. I can use tau equal to I alpha. I alpha is omega 1 dot, and there is no torque. Omega 1 dot is 0. Now, are you getting it?
No, but look, initially you gave it an angular velocity about that axis. And so initially it wasn't changing. However, all the differential equations are coupled with each other. So how are you making that claim for all time? Initially, that is fine.
Yeah, initially that is fine. So I'm assuming that it is only rotating along axis 1.
All right. So you have made that assumption that it's only rotating about axis 1.
Initially, yes. Initially, it is rotating about axis 1.
All right. So when motion started, you gave it an angular velocity such that omega 1 is some non-zero constant and omega 2 and omega 3 are exactly 0.
So that will be an ideal case. I can slightly perturb it.
Okay.
So omega 1, it will be nearly a constant, but because omega 2, omega 3, they will not be completely 0. And as you said, the equations are coupled. They will also have some evolution with time. So it will not be exactly 0, but it will nearly be 0. They will be small. Omega 3 and omega 2 will be small. We'll see that through the equation. So I differentiated 2 and substituted 3 in that. And then I will have this relation. Omega 2 dot dot is this quantity, and this differential equation, if I observe this quantity, it is a negative quantity. I2 is greater than I1 and I2 is less than I3, so it is a negative quantity. And this type of differential equation, they have sinusoidal solution. So omega 2, it will remain bounded, and that's, it will not explode. Omega 2 will not grow. It will have some maximum value, and so it will not go beyond that. Similarly, and that's why this solution is stable. So omega 1, if I give a more perturbation, it will follow certain trajectory, but it will not blow up. Omega 2 will not grow above a certain bound. But if I observe rotation about the intermediate axis, the body is only rotating about omega 2 axis, same assumption will be there. Omega 2 will be much greater than omega 1, and omega 2 will be much greater than omega 3, and omega 2 will nearly be 0, and again I will ignore its time dependence, and I will differentiate 1 in the equation, in the Euler's rigid body equation. I will differentiate 1 and substitute its value of omega 3 dot from 3, and then I will have this relation. Omega 1 dot is this quantity, and the quantity which we see, oh, there is some error. This should be omega 2, or this should be omega 3 here. There is some error. This should be omega 3. So now we see omega 2. This should be omega 2. There is some error here. So Now I see that omega 1, this quantity is a positive quantity, and this equation will have a solution of this type, where C and D, which is definitely positive, when C and D both are positive, and because it is an exponential function, omega 1, it will blow up. And as soon as I give a similar solution, I will have for omega 3. And as soon as I perturb omega 2 along like omega 1, omega will start growing. So this is not mathematically precise because it will. So these solutions, I haven't written the value of C and D. They will give a more information about its behavior. It was these equations were just to used to just to explain that the omega 2 axis, it is unstable, and omega 1 and omega 3, they are stable. I did not perform the same analysis for omega 3, but it will be same as omega 1 analysis. So yes, from this relation it is clear that intermediate axis, it is unstable. Now this analysis can be continued further to check the periodic motion of this behavior, but I will use some geometric approach why this thing occurs, and for that we will look for angular momentum and kinetic energy of this body. So angular momentum of a rigid body, it is given by this, it is again in the body frame, and kinetic energy, it is simply I1 omega squared. And I will use this relation again here to write the kinetic energy in terms of pi1, pi2 and pi3 momentum components, angular momentum components. And because the body, it is not rotating, it is under torque free conditions, the magnitude of body angular momentum, it remains constant, and total kinetic energy, it also remains constant. Total energy, it should remain constant, but there is no potential energy, so kinetic energy is constant. And if we see the total angular momentum is constant, if we see this equation, pi1 square plus pi2 square plus pi3 square equal to h square, this represents a sphere in momentum space. What is momentum space? Momentum space simply a set of coordinate axes with coordinate axes pi1, pi2, pi3, and any point in this momentum space, let's say I choose, it has pi1, pi2 and pi3, that point represents angular momentum of that body at that point. So this is momentum space. Any point in this space, it represents angular momentum of the body. Similarly, so if we see this relation, this relation which comes from angular momentum argument, it is a sphere. It represents a sphere in pi1, pi2 and pi3. While this relation, kinetic energy relation, it represents an ellipsoid. So we know ellipse equation is x square by a plus y square by b equal to constant. Ellipsoid is just adding third dimension to the ellipse. Third dimension is z square by c. So kinetic energy constant remains constant. It gives it is an ellipsoid, while momentum and magnitude of angular momentum is constant, it gives a sphere in momentum space. So and these graphs, they are called poloids. So this angular momentum sphere, it represents, so any point on this sphere, it will show that body has some angular momentum, and this sphere, it is set of all points which have this constant angular momentum h. While this ellipsoid, this is called kinetic energy ellipsoid, this any point on this ellipsoid, it shows the energy of the body. It is locus of all points such that the energy of the body is E. So this sphere, it represents, and the body, it evolves, and rotation will be possible only if this body, if these two graphs, they intersect. So, and that motion, it will occur along the path of intersection. So because intersection is required because these two relations, they are simultaneously satisfied. So body will have rigid body rotation only if these two bollards, they intersect. And now I will use this to analyze how that flipping motion occurs. So first let's see motion in momentum space. So as I said, these two are intersecting. So this blue sphere, it is momentum sphere, angular momentum sphere, and the red ellipsoid, it is kinetic energy ellipsoid, and they intersect along two paths. Here are these two paths. If we see on the other side, they do not intersect. It is symmetric from all the sides. So body only rotates along one of these paths. So if let's say it rotates along this path, so what it says is body will have the z component of angular momentum. If we see z component of angular momentum of the body, it will remain unchanged. Its sign will not change. Its sign will not change. Its magnitude will change. If body is not changing its sign of angular momentum along z direction, then it is not. So its rotation axis, rotation of axis, it is also one component of rotation of axis. It is also along z direction. It will not change its flipping. It will not flip. And similarly, it will slightly wobble around x and y axis, because at every point on this path, the body will have certain angular momentum in y direction as well as certain angular momentum in x direction. And similar motion will be observed if the body, it moves along, if it is given rotation along x axis. Remember, x and z, they are axis 1 and 3. So body, it will perform that wobbling motion. It's if given rotation about x axis, and its x component of angular momentum, it will not change. So in both of these cases, about x and z, the rotation will be stable. It will be oscillating, but the sign will not change. The axis of rotation will not change, the main axis of rotation. So but while this ellipse is growing, so this sphere, it is constant. So this ellipse is growing. What I mean is, I want to keep the magnitude of angular momentum constant, but if I want to move with same magnitude of angular momentum along x direction, I will not have same kinetic energy. I will have higher kinetic energy. So that's why the size of ellipsoid, it will grow. And when it grows, it has multiple paths in between. So I will show the trajectory when the ellipsoid, it grows from, so this ellipsoid, it is just touching the poles along z direction, these two points. It will just touch, and then this will grow slightly, and then they will intersect. And then when it is completely grown, the motion will be observed when the ellipsoid and the sphere, they touch along these two points. One point is behind. When they touch along these two points, the motion will be only the motion will be possible, and that will be pure rotation. Both of them will be pure rotation, which we will see in the next slide. So this will be the set of trajectories. Consider the sphere to be constant angular momentum sphere. And when the motion, when the ellipsoid, it is touching only along these two points. So there is one point which is below. It's not visible in the slide, but there will be a point opposite to this, diametrically opposite to this. So at this point, when ellipsoid and the sphere, they touch at this point, there will be pure rotation about z, because pi 3 corresponds to z direction. When both of them, they touch at this point, they will touch at this point and another point which is diametrically opposite to this. When they touch at this point, they will have pure rotation about x axis. But as we grow away from them, if we go away from them along these trajectories, the wobbling will start. they will start having some components along direction 2 as well as direction 1. So in both of these cases, as I start going away from this, some weird behavior is observed along the axis 2, which is an intermediate axis. And what happens there is, well, let's see in the next slide. So unstable rotations. So while it is going from, while the ellipsoid is growing, one of the trajectories is this. One of the intersection paths is this. So if point is here, it will have pure rotation about y. If slightly perturbed, it will follow the intersection path and it will go just opposite to this. So at this point, it has rotation, pure rotation about positive y-axis, and it will follow the path and it will go along, it will change. So along the path, it will change its direction. It will flip along that direction, along that path, and it will stay there for a while and again follow the same path, follow the other path to come along this direction. So, and it will keep on repeating this for a slight perturbation. So, and this is how this periodic motion it is observed, and it keeps on flipping its direction from positive y direction to negative y direction. And this type of path is observed when the axis, the y axis, it is intermediate axis, and it gives an unstable rotation. So this is how this effect is. This is one explanation of how this effect is observed. And now I will move to the next section, which talks about some applications. If there are any doubts, I will stop here for a while.
Hello.
Hi.
So I just wanted to ask, along the intermediate axis, how will the motion be in physical regime? Like, could you just make us understand how it looks, maybe?
Along this path?
I mean...
Okay. So when it is at this point, the body is purely rotating. Consider your phone. It is... let it be. So let's assume that body is moving. Body is at this position. It has, so its intermediate axis, it's completely along this direction. So body has pure rotation. So consider the wing nut. Yeah. So when I'm at that intersection point, the body, it will purely rotate along this point, along this axis, omega 2. It will have only omega 2. If given slight perturbation, it will evolve along that path, and this axis of rotation, it will change its direction. It will change its flip. It will flip. It will change its direction in the opposite side. So now are you getting how it is evolving?
But what about along omega 1 and omega 3? You were talking about...
About omega 1 and omega 3.
Because the instability that I wanted to see exactly how it will... you were talking about, you derived, right? It is coming out to be some exponential graph, whereas in another case, it is the sinusoidal.
If you see the omega 2, so omega 2 was sinusoidal, that is omega 2 will oscillate. So if given rotation along z direction, which is omega 3, I'm giving z corresponds to 3. So it the body will move along only along this path. So if you check the component of component along 2 direction 2, this body, it will repeat its motion along this path, and that explains its sinusoidal motion.
Maybe can you explain in that figure that the other one which you were showing previously, is it possible?
This This figure?
No, not this one.
So I'm giving motion purely along this rotation along this direction. So
yeah.
It's slightly perturbed. This body it will have only along rotation only along this three axis, and okay. If slightly perturbed, it will start wobbling around this axis. Its axis of rotation will wobble more. It will have higher. The cone will grow. Are you getting it?
Yeah. And similarly, it will be for omega 1.
Similarly, it will be for omega 1 because they both have same relation.
Okay. I mean, like, I just wanted to correlate the exponential part of the thing.
Okay. So, exponential is just for a while. Again, if you see omega 2, it doesn't explode. If we only follow exponential, then it will, at time t equal to infinity, omega 2 should be infinity. It is momentarily. We will have to go into more deeper analysis, which I didn't go with that formulation, but it was locally, it was sufficient to show that omega 2 was unstable.
Thank you.
So this effect can be used. It is just a potential proposed application of this effect in spacecraft. So what is inertial morphing of spacecraft? So before that, it is proposed that this can be used to control attitude of spacecraft. What attitude is? Basically, attitude is just termed to use to represent physical orientation of a rigid body with respect to a frame of reference. So it is just physical orientation of a rigid body, and we always, when I say physical orientation, it is always with respect to a fixed frame of reference. And to parameterize attitude, we use rotation matrices, quaternions, or Euler angles. I have just mentioned their names. If somebody is interested, they can Google what these three things are: rotation matrices, quaternions, or Euler angles. If a rigid body is in particular orientation with respect to an inertial frame, it will have some value of a 3x3 matrix, which is called rotation matrix. Or it will have a quaternion is basically a 4x1 vector. Corresponding to a particular orientation, a body will have some quaternion value, or corresponding to that orientation, body will have a set of angles. These Euler angles, these are again 3x1 vectors. Corresponding to a particular orientation, body will have a 3x1 vector, and these three are interrelated. I have just mentioned this name. If somebody is interested, they can check it out. These are very standard parameterizations of attitude. So for attitude control of spacecraft, usually actuators used are, these are magnetic coils or reaction wheels or thrusters. So how magnetic coils are used, they are fixed at one of the faces of the CubeSat. So there will be three such magnetic coils, and when some current is passed through those coils, they will have certain magnetic moment which will interact with Earth's magnetic field. And that will generate some torque. So this is, and if there is torque, there will be change in some attitude. So magnetic coils are used to control the attitude. Reaction wheels, they are also used. So reaction wheels, they are just wheels. If they are attached at three faces, there could be more. If you change the angular speed of wheel, so the whole body's angular momentum will change, and change in angular momentum causes some torque. So this is how reaction momentum wheels work, or you can call them reaction wheels. The another thing, thrusters, you simply eject some mass and that causes some thrust, and about center of mass, that will generate some torque. So these are the few actuators which are used to control the attitude of spacecrafts. But the proposed application is, can you change attitude by changing moment of inertia? So this is a recent research which is going on. So this is possible by moving masses inside the spacecraft using special devices. Moving mass will cause the change of inertia, and we just saw change the orientation of the body. It can be changed because if it is rotating about intermediate axis, mass distribution can also be changed by using moving liquids or by evaporating mass. If you evaporate mass, you are ejecting some mass of the spacecraft is losing some mass, and that will again change its moment of inertia. And solidification, it will change. There will be some change in density, or again that will again bring some change in moment of inertia. So these are some proposed methodologies which cause change in moment of inertia, and that can be how that can be used for attitude control. So I will consider a basic spacecraft model. Morphing it means just changing attitude by changing moment of inertia. So I will consider a morphing spacecraft. It is a very basic model. So consider so it has six masses. They are placed along each coordinate axis. Two masses along each coordinate axis, and they are symmetrically placed. Mx is symmetrically placed on x axis. My they are placed on y axis symmetrically, and mz similarly symmetrically placed there. Placed on z axis, and they are at distances rx, ry, rz, and all connecting rods, they are massless, and the assumption is that all the rods, they are connected at the center, and these masses they can be moved they can be moved along their corresponding axis. So my can be moved along y direction, mz can be moved along z direction, mx can be moved along x direction. When I move this mx, this will also move. That is assumed. I will maintain the symmetry. So using simple relations, I can write ixx. Ixx is because of masses my and mz, which is given by this. Similarly, I can write iyy, izz, and there I will solve these equations to get rx, r. Moment of inertia. If I know moment of inertia of this system, so this morphing, it is achieved by controlling the positions of these masses. So if I change the position of these masses, so let's say I change the position of mz along z direction, so that will cause my ixx to fall, iyy will also reduce, izz will remain unchanged. But IXX and IYY, they will change, and that will cause change in moment of inertia, and the role of intermediate axis, that will be transferred from one axis, one direction to other direction. We'll see through results. So let's assume that each mass is of 1 kg, and I move Z mass along the Z direction from I move the masses along z direction. So initially the mass, so this is plot of positions of masses, but with respect to time. So I will keep rx, ryy constant, rxx constant, and I will move rz from 1.2 meter to 0.6 meter. From 1.2 meter to 0.6 meter, I will move, and corresponding to that, if I plot moment of inertia, so izz, it remains unchanged. Izz, it remains unchanged because it depends only on positions of x and y masses. But iyy and izz, they drop, and at 0.33 second iyy, it intersects izz, and 0.67 second ixx, it intersects izz. So before this line, before 0.33 second, my moment of inertia, my intermediate axis, it was only along intermediate axis was iyy. But after 0.33 second, the role of intermediate axis, it is transferred from iyy to izz. Now initially I had at before 0.33, I had the iyy was unstable, but after 0.33 second, izz axis will be unstable, And after 0.67 second, IXX axis will be unstable. So it is possible to transfer the role of intermediate axis from one direction to other direction by changing the position of mass only in one direction. So this was the result of this, and this is just the concept proposed to change the attitude of spacecraft. And I would also want to stop the spinning along some axis. And how is that done? Let's see. So just don't look at it right now. Just see what is the condition here. So MX, MY, MZ, these are of 1 kg. And initially my IXX is 0.33 kg meter square, IYY is 0.35 and IZZ is 0.4. So initially IYY is intermediate moment, intermediate axis. So even if we see the plot, IYY here, it is intermediate axis, and IXX is 0.3, it is lowest, and IZ is highest. So what if I want to stop spinning about, when it is along the Y direction, I want to stop it spinning. I want to make Y axis stable. What I will do, So corresponding to this situation, my paw loads, they will look like this. And I want to stop motion. I want to stop it flipping, but I want to make it move only along Y direction. I want to keep its rotation only along Y direction. So what I will do, we'll suddenly change the IYY moment of inertia from 0.3 to some value near to 0.2. And now we see that the axis of rotation, and when we do that, the ellipsoid, so this paw load, they change from, they start touching at the poles along the Y direction. So if what this means is it will have pure rotation about Y axis. So this is how, by suddenly changing the Y direction, moment of inertia along Y direction, I can stabilize the Y axis. Similarly, I decreased Y axis, but X direction was unstable. If I increase the moment of inertia along Y direction, in that case, what will happen? This ellipsoid, it will fall. It will shrink. So again, they will touch along one direction, and the IZZ will be unstable. So this is how I can stop the inertial. I can stop the flipping due to this effect. And so yeah, this was the one of the application which is proposed. There is deep analysis, further detailed analysis is required to accurately control the position. There have been few research papers which have been developed, which show that the spacecraft can be moved from one orientation to another orientation using this effect. But they are very new papers. So this is one basic condition which I took from them, one of them. And so, yes. The changing mass distribution, it is possible by a controlled deployment of solar arrays in space. So that will change the angular moment, that will change the moment of inertia, or we can use moving fluids. So this is a piston cylinder assembly, and there is some fluid here. We can compress it and change the distribution of, we can bring the fluid near to the x-axis, and that will change the moment of inertia. So it is same as moving the z-direction masses towards the origin. So these are the few variations of this which can be used to which can be invoked to perform this maneuvers. And so yes, about Earth, as I said, it is spinning about its stable axis. And the these are my references, and yeah, I'm done. So if there are any doubts. I can share these references with you and Sangram, and then you can share it with others if they are interested. yeah. There are some YouTube videos which they can have a look at. Which two of them, they also explain this phenomena. And I will play one of the videos to clear one of you asked the doubt how to visualize that motion. Okay. So at this position, when the ellipsoids, they are touching the body, it will rotate. Is this video visible first?
Yeah, it is visible.
Okay, I'm assuming it is visible. So when they are touching the book, it will rotate only one direction, and as it grows, the wobbling starts. The cone becomes, the base of the cone, it becomes larger. And you can see that blue dot that shows its behavior with time, and it grows larger and larger, and you will see it starts flattening. And if we see the rotation about the other axis, other stable axis. As it grows, there will be slight wobbling about the other two axes, but it will have major rotation about the stable axis, the perpendicular axis, which is perpendicular to the book, plane of the book. Now, if we see, yeah, so along this path, clear, observe the book, how it changes its flipping direction. Did you observe? So you can, it is clear if you see, if you observe the title of the book, its orientation is changed. So I hope through this video it was clear, the rotational motion along the path of intersection, it was clear.
Yes, Dhananjan, thank you.
So so Sangram, I'm done.
Yeah, okay. So thank you, Dhananjay, for conducting a very nice talk. I really enjoyed it, and I hope the participants enjoyed it as well. It was really fascinating how it all worked. Yeah, and thank you all of you, Dhananjay, as well as the audience, and yeah, we hope to see you in another one of our current talks. Okay, thanks.